All right. Well, good morning and welcome. It is so good to see all of you this morning. This is a setting that, I've been trying to envision it all week, so it's actually really cool to see this happening this morning. We're excited to welcome you to Grace Bible Church and just thrilled that we're able to gather as a body this morning. We have some special guests with us here this morning as well. You may have seen the Kalenas, some of their families here from all the way from Germany, so some of our partners in mission. So they're in the back there. And just thrilled to be able to have them with us and been able to catch up a little bit and hear about their ministry there. And hopefully can have a time of refreshment as they're here in the States. And so we're thankful to have them with us. Also, the Hoffmans are here as well. So amazing, huh? So it's great to be able to share in all this as a family together. We want to thank you for your patience and just working with us in all of this. And I just also wanted to make us aware of the opportunity to give special thanks to many who have put in many hours in meetings and making sacrifices and efforts to have the things that you're seeing happen here today happen. And so I know those people definitely wouldn't want to be called up front or anything like that, but it is a Christian response for us to be able to give thanks to God for the way he's designed the body with all these different gifts and willingness to serve in this way so that we can meet. So that's just a huge blessing for us this morning. We also just want to remember, for those who aren't with us today, I think they're represented by this camera over here, but whether that's because it's not your letter of the alphabet or if there are other reasons why you're not able to be with us, we just want you to know that you're loved and missed and you are a part of the body and worshiping together with us by the Holy Spirit. So we want to continue to remember, even during these times, our body spread out all over San Diego in particular. I mentioned before, make sure you grab a bulletin and then elements for the Lord's Supper. If you didn't do that, you could just slip up your hand and some of the ushers would be happy to get things to you as well. So just take note of that. While it's an exciting time that we have special visitors and guests with us this morning, it's also another time to say goodbye. And so Tom's going to come and pray for Charity. This is her last Sunday with us. We're so thankful for Charity's time with us, and we're excited about the internship that she has in Michigan for this next year. And Tom can fill us in, and then we'll continue from there.
To pray for new members and also pray for members who are leaving. It's with mixed emotions that Charity is leaving. Most of you know Charity is, her home is in Uganda, and she came to the United States to attend seminary. So she recently graduated with a master's degree in biblical studies from a seminary that has very rigid, rigorous academics. And she also has this wonderful opportunity to participate in a one-year women's ministry internship where the Cornerstone Baptist Church in Michigan will invest in her over the next year. She'll learn to teach Bible studies, she'll learn how to counsel from the Bible, and she'll end up certified as a certified biblical counselor by the time that's over. So she'll have the perfect complement of the academics and then the practical internship before she goes back home to Uganda. So let's pray for her sister. Charity, would you stand up? Heavenly Father, we pray for our dear sister, our friend, and our co-worker in the gospel. We're so grateful that in your good providence, you brought her here all the way from around the world to be a member of our church. We thank you how you abundantly have provided for her needs through the seminary's generosity, through friends, through our church. And we thank you for the grace to see her through these academics. And we're so excited, Lord, about her internship opportunity. It's exactly what we have been praying for. Bring her safely to Michigan. Give her the practical training she needs in teaching the Bible. and in counseling from your word, and then return her home to her family, to her friends, to ministry. Use her as a ministry leader, both in her church and across her country. Help her to always remember that ministry is loving people. Use her education, her internship, and her time at GBC to do beyond what we could think or even dream of. And Lord, we'll miss her. Help us in that way. And then help her heart. As she's away from home, she'll be away from us. Help her to not feel alone, but may she make friends and even lifelong relationships. And we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
There's probably about a handful of you who were with us when the church first started. It reminds me a lot of those days. We met in a home. We met in a hotel conference room. We met in a daycare center, an auditorium. I don't think we ever met outside, though. This is probably the first time. So, these are reminders. This is not our home. Our home is in heaven. One day we'll see our Savior, and we look forward to that day. But for now, we're sojourners. We're even reminded of that a little bit, being outside today and seeing those who've come from afar, all the way from China and Germany. Very thankful to be together this morning. I'm going to ask you to stand. You can do that. I hope you'll do that. We're going to, our call to worship is from Isaiah 49, verse 13. Isaiah says, "Sing for joy, O heavens, and exalt, O earth. Break forth, O mountains, into singing. For the Lord has comforted his people, and will have compassion on his afflicted." God's proved that, hasn't he? He's demonstrated that by sending his son into this broken, lost world, giving us a Savior who we can rejoice in, who we can sing to. And that's what we're going to do this morning. And so on your bulletin, first few songs we're going to sing this morning, "Shout to the Lord" and "Our Great God." Let's join our voices together. blessing on this service this morning. Exalt yourself in our midst. And we'll thank you, Jesus.
You can be seated. Scripture reading this morning is from the book of Psalms, chapter 23. You can turn there now or find it in your bulletin. Psalm 23, a psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Please pray with me. Father, we come to you now as your adopted children. By the Spirit, fill our hearts now with the boldness and assurance that is ours in Christ. Boldness to approach your throne of grace. Lord, help us now to pray. Help us to remember who you are, that you are the one true and living God, the great I Am, creator and sustainer of all that exists. Lord, the created order depends upon you for its very existence, and yet you are in no way dependent upon the creation. You are free and sovereign, complete in yourself. You have no need nor lack. You do not grow wiser or better in any way, for you are and remain perfect in every way. Thank you that though you are high above us, holy and far beyond our reach and comprehension, yet you have condescended in love and mercy and fully revealed yourself to us in your only begotten Son. Thank you for sending your Son in the fullness of time to do what we could not do for ourselves. Father, regardless of how we feel today, the truth is that we have made a mess of this last week. We have not come close to giving you the love and obedience and worship you deserve. We have turned back again to idols of the heart. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. Forgive us, Lord. Wash us thoroughly from our iniquities. Cleanse us from our sin. Help us look afresh to the all-sufficient sacrifice of Christ, that we might know that our sins are indeed forgiven for his sake, that we are in your omnipotent grip. Thank you, Lord, for the inexpressible gift of salvation in Christ. Thank you for powerfully calling us to faith, for justifying us and adopting us into your family. Thank you for your ongoing commitment to form Christ in us, and for your promise that you will indeed finish the work you began in us and bring us safely into your everlasting kingdom. Thank you for so great a salvation. Father, we ask now that you would encourage the faint-hearted among us, those who are listening. Lord, please comfort those that are suffering from loneliness or discouragement. Strengthen those who are overwhelmed by doubt. Give light to those in darkness and despair. Draw near to us. Give us more of yourself, more of your presence. Make us know that you are near. Thank you for being a God for sinners and strugglers. Thank you that a bruised reed you will not break and a smoldering wick you will not snuff out. And that all who draw near to you in and through Christ will never be turned away. Thank you for being our God. Amen. Father, please speak to us today through Craig. Bless the preached word. May it take root in our hearts and bear much fruit. We ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. Actually, several of us were wandering around in the side yard and around the streets doing sound level checks to make sure it's within code of all these kinds of things. And as we were doing that, I was envisioning what would happen this Sunday morning as we gather here in this lawn, on this lawn. And I thought during that time of how much of Jesus' ministry was outdoors. Fascinating to think about, isn't it? Much of it taught outdoors on grass in a climate very similar to our own. And it just seemed like it would be fitting for us to spend some time together this morning considering one of the times of Jesus' ministry, in particular, his feeding of the 5,000. And I know we covered this a few years ago when we went through the book of Mark, but I think that what Jesus reveals about himself in this section is it's always relevant, but especially relevant to us, even as we're seated out here on the relatively green grass today, this morning. So let me read our passage in Mark 6, verses 30 to 44. For some reason, I left off verse 44 in your bulletin. There's nothing against it. I like even numbered verses, but I'll read it for you, and you can just hear the last verse if you're following along in your bulletin. But Mark chapter 6, starting in verse 30 through 44. God's word. The apostles returned to Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. And he said to them, "Come away by yourselves to a desolate place and rest a while, for many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a desolate place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they ran there on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. And when it grew late, his disciples came to him and said, 'This is a desolate place, and the hour is now late. Send them away to go into the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat.' But he answered them, 'You give them something to eat.' And they said to him, 'Shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give it to them to eat?' And he said to them, 'How many loaves do you have? Go and see.' When they had found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then he commanded them all to sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups by hundreds and by fifties. And taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and said a blessing and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples to set before the people. And he divided the 2 fish among them all. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces and of the fish. And those who ate the loaves were 5,000 men." Please join me in prayer as we ask our Lord's help as we consider this word this morning. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the blessing of hearing from you through your word. We think of the many who have gone before us and who, some of whom actually heard the words from our Savior on his lips outside. And we think of the great privilege we have of hearing his voice by the Spirit this morning. We pray that you would illumine our hearts so that we could hear and understand and not only just see the truth of your word, but that we could be changed by it, that we would become doers of the word, that we would come to more fully know this word that you have implanted in us of the new creation that is ours now through the work of Jesus Christ. We ask all these things in his name. Amen. Well, as we consider March 6th, I know we're just kind of diving in, and one of the important things to understand is the context of what's been taking place. Jesus has sent the disciples out in pairs. He sent them out to cast out demons and to heal the sick. And now the disciples have come back. They've come back with this report of what they had done and taught. But their ability to report this was interrupted by some circumstances that were taking place. Many people were coming and going, and they weren't able to even get time to eat, let alone to sit down and to recap what had taken place. So Jesus, in his care for them, initiates a trip to a desolate place, a wilderness by themselves, where there weren't distractions of comings and goings of cars and the like. He took them out to a desolate place so that they could recap about what God had been doing among them. But many noticed their attempt to get away, and somehow they followed them. I don't know if they ran along and could keep their eyes on the boat to see where Jesus and the disciples are going, but somehow this great crowd of people arrives ahead of them at this location. And the initial plans that were given were really thwarted by this change. And in this experience, we get an amazing glimpse into Jesus' perspective on such a different situation than what they had set out to do. It gives us a window into his very heart of how he understands these circumstances. And verse 34 tells us he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. There are a few things that are important to notice about this text, and I think the first one is this, that Jesus saw the people as sheep. When Jesus looked out on this great crowd that had arrived and was looking for his attention, he saw them as sheep. You know, we're used to hearing this word when we read the Bible, aren't we? Oh, God views his people as sheep. But stop and think about what this means for just a moment. It's not the most flattering term, is it, to be called sheep? It's interesting how humbling it really is. And when Jesus comes ashore, it's fascinating that it doesn't say that he saw the people as courageous lions just waiting to be instructed. He saw them as mighty eagles full of energy and strength. No, when he comes and sees people in their weakness and in their need, he sees them as sheep. It's a reminder to all of us that no matter what we may think of ourselves and our own abilities or prowess or whatever it may be, that before God, we are viewed as sheep. On one hand, that's really humbling, isn't it? But on the other hand, it's actually really comforting when we humbly embrace our identity as sheep. The entire context of this account is that of people who are in overwhelming need. They're stretched beyond their abilities to care for themselves, to find food. They're coming with great need. The group is large. The place is desolate. And Jesus, as he comes, because he sees them as sheep, he's not at all surprised by their need. Their very need, their very weakness, actually moves the heart of Jesus. He doesn't arrive on shore and say, "Can you call me back when you've got it all figured out?" But instead, he enters in to meet their very need. And so on the one hand, it's really humbling to realize that we are sheep. But on the other hand, it's comforting to realize that when Jesus looks at you, he doesn't look at you as someone who needs to have it all together. He doesn't look at you as someone who needs to have it all figured out or know the solutions to everything that you're facing or what to do. He sees you in your weakness. He sees you in your need as a sheep. And not only did Jesus see the people as sheep, but Jesus knew that the people needed a shepherd. When we hear the term shepherd, we probably rightfully consider a person who cares for the sheep. And if we've studied background, we know how intensive and involved that is to actually live among the sheep and to care for their every need.
But one of the things that we may not be as familiar with is how much the term shepherd refers to leadership, how much it involves kingliness and rule. It's been interesting, as we've been studying Exodus, one of the things that I found surprising is how many depictions of the pharaohs in drawings or reliefs show them holding a mini shepherd staff. Why is that? Because the pharaoh was king, he was shepherd. And that's how it's viewed biblically as well. Moses used this phrase in the book of Numbers, sheep without a shepherd, to describe how God's people would need a leader to take them into the promised land, namely Joshua. In that famous passage of Ezekiel 34, the prophet indicts the rulers of the people of Israel for their failure to shepherd the sheep. So Jesus sees the people in need of a shepherd, in need of a leader, in need of a king. But there's something else that's happening here that we may not immediately see. The people were also looking to Jesus to be that shepherd, to be that leader. This passage is loaded with messianic expectations. The people came to Jesus. Part of the reason they were running there to meet him is because they were looking for a Messiah, a leader king to save them. It's shown to us in several subtle details in the narrative. One is that the setting of this whole account is in northern Galilee. And if you know your history of that area in that time, northern Galilee was known to be home base for the Zealot movement. And the Zealot movement, do you remember what that was all about? It was all about overthrowing Rome. Overthrowing Rome because Rome was interfering with the people's ability to worship and live life the way that they thought they should. And so the Zealots were seeking to overthrow the Roman government by force. And so we see that in the setting of where this took place, but then linguistically, there's some phrases there that are really loaded with military and kingship overtones. This phrase, sheep without a shepherd, occurs only a few times in the Old Testament, and one of the times that it does is speaking explicitly of soldiers who needed a king when King Ahab had been killed in battle. And so there's military and soldier overtones in this phrase, sheep without a shepherd. And remember at the end in verse 44, when we get the number of the people who were there, how does it describe the crowd? 5,000 men. Now, that is a way you could describe a crowd, but it's strange for a mixed group, which we surely know that it was. And in fact, 5,000 men is a much better way to describe an army or a contingent of force. And so Mark is having us read this through the lens of this expectation of the Zealot movement of looking for a leader. If you say, well, Craig, that's all a bit subtle. I don't really see that there in the text. There's a convincing factor here as well. In John chapter 6, after this sign of feeding the 5,000, what did the people seek to do to Jesus? They sought to make him king by force. You see, so as we come to this context, these people have an expectation that they need a leader who will help them deal with their problems. And the problem that they were explicitly aware of and focusing on was the wicked government that was oppressing them and affecting their ability to be God's people. I felt the weight of the context of this entire account in a very real way lately, and maybe you have as well. I think we're all realizing how intense the temptation is to put our hope and our effort in the desire for external change, to have policies removed, or maybe policies that will enable us to live and to worship as we believe that we're called to do. And the people in Jesus' day were facing similar scenarios. And yet Jesus, aware of this expectation, he calls them to think about and to focus on something very different. They need a shepherd, and he knows that, but not in the way that they think they do. Jesus shows them
that he is the shepherd who cares. He is the shepherd who cares. In verse 34, it says, when he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them. This word compassion is a significant term. It refers in its noun form to one's inner organs. B.B. Warfield says that this word describes profound internal movement of an emotional nature. Jesus' longings and inward desires were stirred up when he saw the needs of these people in front of him. And this word, this term, is only used of Jesus in the New Testament. Consistently, over and over again, Jesus is shown as the one who is moved by people, and in particular, people who are in need. Well, how does Jesus show this compassion? What does he do? He taught them. He cared for their spiritual needs. They needed to hear a message that day. And they needed to hear a message of God's kingdom that had broken in among them. The kingdom that Jesus himself was bringing to them through his life, death, and resurrection. And it was a kingdom that was coming regardless of what Rome or Herod did. And so he taught them about the nature of this kingdom. And then he fed them. He has the crowd sit down. And then Jesus functions as the host of the meal. He's probably smoother about it than I am with my name. Jesus functions as the host of the meal. He took bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it and the fish to the disciples to distribute. And Mark gives an important detail in his account of the text. He tells us that the people sat down on green grass. Think of that imagery that's happening there. These people who are all wearing wool-colored clothes. They're wearing whitish-colored tunics, and they're there scattered among green grass. And think of the imagery of what this looked like to Jesus based on the words we know of how he saw the people as sheep. It calls to mind the words of Psalm 23, doesn't it? The Lord is the shepherd who leads his people beside the still waters, who makes his people lie down in green pastures, who prepares a table before them in the presence of their enemies. Jesus is showing himself as a shepherd, as a ruler, as a king, but as the good shepherd who truly cares for his sheep wherever their journey may take them. And the context of this passage is entirely in contrast with another king. Right before this account in chapter 6 is the account of Herod and the death of John the Baptist. And it's striking how it's the complete opposite of everything that Jesus is saying and doing. Herod, rather than having concern for the crowd, the sheep entrusted to his care, he throws a lavish party for himself. Rather than giving these people the truth that they need to hear, what does he do? He kills God's prophet. He chops off his head. Rather than caring for the true needs of his sheep, he's more concerned about his reputation among the guests. So in contrast to Herod, Jesus, from start to finish, is one who is putting the needs of his sheep ahead of himself. And he demonstrates his care for everyone involved. And this isn't all that this passage calls to mind. Because really this passage is just a foreshadowing, a taste of the greater care that Jesus will show for his sheep, isn't it? There's another passage that radically shapes our understanding of sheep and shepherd imagery. And that's in Zechariah 13, where it's foretold that the shepherd will be struck and the sheep will be scattered. You see, it's no coincidence that the exact same words that Mark uses here to describe Jesus feeding the crowd are the exact same words he uses later in chapter 14 to describe his institution of the Lord's Supper. It tells us there that he took, he blessed, he broke, and he gave. You see, Jesus shows that his shepherding, His kingship, his rule, is one that comes through sacrifice. That he is the shepherd and also the lamb who is slain for his needy sheep. Jesus knew that their biggest problem was not Rome. It was not the kingdoms of this world or even the hunger that they were facing that night in a desolate place. But their biggest problem was their sin and their need of a shepherd who cared for them. And so by living a perfect life, and then by being struck down for them, crushed for their iniquities, he has truly cared for all his sheep who have gone astray. And so the great news this morning is that if you are looking to Jesus Christ in faith, and you are trusting him for the forgiveness of sins, you have come under the care of this good shepherd who is with you all along life's journey. Do you see Jesus as a shepherd who cares for you as one of his sheep? Do you believe that Jesus sees you in your need? He sees you in your weakness. He sees you in your struggle. And his heart moves towards you in affection, in help, in welcoming care. When you're weak in faith, when you're struggling with doubt, when that sin that you have struggled with your whole life, you just did it again because all the pressures that are being put on you have built to this point. You see him as a shepherd who cares when those who were supposed to lead and protect you seem to care only for themselves. Or when the cares of this world have left you exhausted and feeling famished. We're reminded that in the face of our true need, Jesus is not bothered, he's not annoyed, but he's moved. Dane Ortlund in his book, Gentle and Lowly, says, "The Jesus given to us in the Gospels is not simply one who loves, but one who is loved. And merciful affections stream from his innermost heart as rays from the sun." We hide from the intensity of the sun's rays, especially as we sit out here this morning. But with Jesus, what emanates from his heart are that intensity of rays of care in our weakness and in our need. And if that's how Jesus cared for a hungry crowd, if that's how he shows his care to sinful sheep who have gone astray, then what do you think his posture is towards us now? This Jesus who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. His care for his sheep has not lessened one bit, but instead is now accessible to all who are his by the very Spirit that he has sent to his people. So do you see Jesus as a shepherd who cares? And then a second thing that we really should consider in this text is, do we see others as Jesus does? When he sees people in their weakness, when he sees them in their need, when he sees them at the end of themselves and not having any solutions to the problems that they face, he sees them as sheep. Many people are at their wits' end among us these days. People are being tried and tested and stretched in ways that many of us have never experienced before. And the question Jesus asks us is, how do we see them? How do we read their posts? How do we hear their frustrations and cares? How do we see them in the store or as we drive? Do we see them as sheep who are in need of care? You see, those who follow the Good Shepherd, our Lord Jesus, we start to see things like he sees them. We start to hear people as he hears them, and we think and we can respond in the way that he responds. And how much would it change things if our response to people's need was to move towards them in care? Not on a mission to change them, but on a mission to show them the care of our Good Shepherd and to hold forth the good news of one who cares about them more than we ever could. You know, as we sit here on the grass, or as we sit in our homes, as some who are a part of us are doing, we're reminded again that we are tempted to look around and to put our hope to put our effort, to put our allegiance into changing our circumstances, to changing our kings, to changing our rules. But Jesus, he meets us where we are, in our very need, in our weariness, in our frustration, even in our zeal. And he calls us to consider something else. He knows that the thing that we need most is a shepherd who truly cares for us. And he invites you to come, to sit down, to receive his teaching, his word, his truth, and to be fed with the very presence of Christ himself by his Spirit. And to know that this good shepherd will lead you, will care for you, and be with you by his Spirit through whatever the journey of this life entails. Until one day, we reach those heavenly green pastures and we sit down for the greatest meal that can ever be enjoyed by God's people. Will you join with me in prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the revelation of our Savior Jesus Christ and how he came in flesh and showed us what it looks like to see compassion and care wrapped in humanity. And we thank you that the same Savior who cared for those people so long ago is the one who is presently caring for us now by the Spirit. And this all comes from the love and mercy and grace and compassion that you have poured out upon us freely by your grace. Will you strengthen our feeble hearts and our weak faith? Will you lift our eyes to see a Savior who cares and is with us, and to hold forth that glorious news to those who are so desperately in need of that kind of leadership and rule? We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our Lord Jesus invites us to a meal today. And hopefully you picked up the elements for the Lord's Supper on your way in. If you didn't, just slip up your hand and one of our ushers would be happy to make sure that happens for you. Looks like everyone got to get a chance to do that, I believe. Our Lord Jesus invites us to a meal where we receive signs of his body and his blood that were given for us as he was crushed for our iniquities. This is a time that's for believers. It's for those who have professed faith in Jesus for the forgiveness of sins and who have shown entrance into that covenant relationship through baptism. So if that applies to you, you are welcome to partake with us as a brother or sister in Christ. Those of you who are joining us at home, we realize that you are fasting in a sense. But we want you to know for sure today that if you're looking to Christ, all the blessings of the new covenant are most certainly yours, and that he cares for you and will feed you with himself and shower his grace upon you, even if you're not here with us receiving it in the same way. I want to call our attention to the words of Isaiah 53 as we consider what our good shepherd has done for us as sheep. In verse 6 it says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." And then in verse 10 it says, "Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring and prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide with him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors." Let's pray and give thanks for all that our Lord has done for us. Our Father in heaven, we thank you that in our weakness, while we were still enemies, Christ died for us, and that through his death, our iniquities, our transgressions, our sins have been forgiven. And new life has welled up within us. And we are now part of this resurrection life of the new creation that in his resurrection and ascension, he has secured for us. We pray that you would strengthen us and reassure us of the surety of these promises, that God has sworn by himself that all these things will truly come to pass, and we will be your people, and you will be our God forever. We thank you for all this through the work of Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. You should have received a prepackaged set of elements, and at this time you can open that top portion if you haven't already and take out the wafer. This is a sign for us of the body of Christ that was given for us. In Mark 14, it says, as they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, and he gave it to them and said, take, this is my body. And if you haven't opened it already, you carefully remove the lid for the cup. That night at the Last Supper, it says, and he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. And then, that night, even before he had suffered and died, he uttered these amazing, confident words of what awaited him. He said, truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. And our Lord Jesus will come again, and we will feast with him one day. And even so, we say, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Amen.
In your bulletin, you have the last song we're going to sing this morning. And the last verse, I think, is really helpful to focus upon. It says, pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer, to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine. With 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Let's stand and conclude our service this morning by singing this great song.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you for our service of worship this morning. We pray, Father, that you would do great things in this dark world. Save the lost. Encourage your people. Help us in our pilgrimage. And we'll give you thanks. Because you are a God who is faithful. Nothing can separate us from your love. And for this, we thank you. In Jesus' name.